What if we get all medical here? On Today I Found Out, we reach out to paramedic and Davin's brother, Scott. Scott is also one of the hosts of the Medical Confessions podcast, which is linked to below, and you should definitely go check out. In it, they cover all manner of topics, from why spinach really is genuinely a performance-enhancing drug, why almost literally everyone has herpes, does sex before other athletic events actually hinder performance, and a lot more. Links below. And in the video today, we're answering a question with, of course, Scott's assistance, because KTO asks us, how much coffee would someone have to drink for it to be fatal? Oh dear. There's no coffee in here. I finished it already. There have been numerous deaths attributed to excessive caffeine ingestion. So if you happen to be a person who loves coffee and energy drinks, you might want to know approximately what amount you should avoid drinking on any given day. So how much caffeine would actually kill you? I'm actually quite curious to know, because I do not drink a small amount of coffee. Well, there are several factors that make this a tricky question to answer. For example, not everyone reacts the same way to caffeine. People also become tolerant to it, and so the effects can be different from person to person. Lastly, there would be no respectable researcher who would dare perform a study on humans if the goal of that study is the death of the person. Thus, as you might expect, we couldn't find any studies that show what amount of caffeine would definitely kill your average human. But that's not very interesting. Is it? So let's dig a little deeper, shall we? First of all, what we did is we went and gathered 100 volunteers who were tired of living, along with some that we just found on the streets and figured they should be in quarantine, and we just decided to overdose them on caffeine and see what... Not really. But seriously, it does turn out there are less ethically questionable studies that have allowed doctors to understand what's going on inside the body in caffeine overdoses and approximately what dose would prove fatal for the average person. So while the exact dose is almost impossible to answer for a given individual, we can say for sure a few things, like that the highest caffeine dose ever known to be ingested by someone who survived it was around 100 grams. Although that might not sound like much, in terms of raw amount of caffeine, it should be noted that that's the amount of caffeine in about 1,200 cups of coffee. Lesser doses that are generally thought to put an adult at a high risk of death typically range from about 5 to 10 grams ingested in a short period, which is still an awful lot of energy drinks and coffee. Though there are certain diet pills that can easily get you over that amount in just a handful of pills. Now, of course, people ingesting significantly lesser doses have had death attributed to caffeine overdose. That said, others survive where you'd think they wouldn't, such as one medical report looking at the case of an unnamed one-year-old girl who ingested some of her mother's diet pills. The total dose of caffeine to the one-year-old was approximately 3 grams. While said baby did have significant complications, including heart issues and seizures in the immediate aftermath, she survived the incident and did not seem to suffer any long-term issues. Noteworthy here is that due to her tiny size, the caffeine concentration in her system ended up being the second highest ever documented in someone who survived the event. But still, keep your diet pills out of reach of your kids, for God's sake. Yet another research paper we looked at documented the case of a 16-year-old boy who ingested around 6 to 8 grams of caffeine and also managed to survive despite a number of immediate medical complications as a result of the caffeine. So basically, there are a myriad of factors at play here, but as for a definitive dose that would kill most people, it turns out when talking cups of coffee or energy drinks, it's a huge amount in most people, with some exceptions where individuals with certain heart conditions and the like might want to avoid significantly smaller doses. As for the average Joe, most physicians and medical bodies tend to recommend avoiding ingesting more than around 500 to 600 milligrams of caffeine per day, not necessarily because you might die per se, but more because it's likely not going to be good for you for a variety of reasons, especially if done regularly. For reference, the average cup of coffee has in the range of 40 to 150 milligrams of caffeine. For example, a Starbucks 2X caffeine K-cup will get you a dose of around 260 milligrams. I'm fairly au fait with the Starbucks menu. I've never heard of a 2X caffeine K-cup. I guess it's an American thing, and that's an extraordinary amount of caffeine in it. This is compared to the normally caffeinated K-cup from the same brand, which has around 130 milligrams. Obviously, if you follow the recommendations, you'll want to avoid more than two of the 2X caffeine K-cups per day. For other references, 12 ounces of Jolt Cola has approximately 100 grams. Let me just put that into normal units. 12 ounces in mils. 12 ounces in mils. 354, so like just bigger than a regular can of Coke. For other references, 12 ounces, 355, basically, mils of jolt cola is approximately 100 milligrams, 16 ounces at about 160 milligrams, Monster Energy at about 160 milligrams, 12 ounces of Mountain Dew has 55 milligrams, and Dr. Pepper has 61 milligrams. So all of this might have you wondering how caffeine actually manages to kill. Caffeine is one of several naturally occurring substances known as xanthines. Xanthines are, among other things, I'm going to check the pronunciation on xanthines, because it's got an X at the beginning, which is always a bit weird. X-A-N-thines. Xanthines. Come on. Tell me.
Xanthines.
Xanthines. Caffeine is one of several naturally occurring substances known as xanthine. Xanthines are, among other things, central nervous system CNS stimulants. Caffeine specifically is in over 60 known plant species. It's the most widely consumed psychoactive substance in the world. Depending on what study you read, approximately 80 to 90% of the US population consumes at least 200 milligrams per day. In low doses, it has many benefits that can help with things like pain management, water retention, alertness, and a general feeling of well-being, to name a few. As with most CNS stimulants, the higher the dose, the more profound this reaction. As you consume more caffeine, the risks do begin to outweigh the benefits. A person can become jittery, anxious, begin having high blood pressure, chest pain, headaches, dehydration, and, unfortunately, dependence that causes withdrawal if you don't continue consuming it. Yeah, you know those mornings where it's like, you don't have a cup of coffee and it's like, why does my head hurt? Oh yeah. Because I got a serious caffeine addiction. In toxic doses, caffeine can cause extremely low blood pressure, seizures, cardiac rhythm problems, and lactic acidosis. While there appears to be some dissension among researchers as to how exactly xanthines like caffeine cause the reactions they do, what is known is that they antagonize what are known as adenosine receptors within almost every cell in your body. Adenosine is a chemical present in every human cell. It combines with other chemicals like phosphate to create numerous compounds that help cells work properly. Those compounds need to attach their receptors to affect cells. There are four main groups of adenosine receptors within the body, and their effects can fall into four categories. Generally speaking, adenosine compounds help in increasing the oxygen available to cells, protect against the damage caused by a lack of oxygen, help in initiating the body's natural anti-inflammatory responses, and help in the creation of blood vessels. Caffeine is similar to adenosine in chemical composition, and as such can attach to adenosine receptors, not allowing adenosine compounds to perform normally. The result is CNS and cardiac stimulation, relaxation of the smooth muscles, and a diuretic action on the kidneys that can lead to dehydration. Thus, in high levels, caffeine can be very toxic. It will bind to adenosine receptor sites known as subtypes A1 and A2. The result is seizures. In high doses, it will also inhibit an enzyme known as phosphodiesterase while stimulating the release of neurotransmitters involved in your fight or flight nervous system. The result is extremely fast heart rates, dilation of your blood vessels causing low blood pressures, low potassium levels that can cause lethal heart rhythms, the breakdown of sugars in your liver, and an increase in your white blood cells. If all of that doesn't seem like it's deadly enough, kinda does, doesn't it? Those side effects will cause their own problems. Specifically, lactic acidosis will be caused by your body's tissues not getting enough oxygen because your blood pressure is too low. The results of your seizures, low oxygen levels within your cells, and inevitable calcium release from an area of your cells called your endoplasmic reticulum will give you what is known as rhabdomyolysis. This is the breakdown of your muscles, causing a release of your muscle fibers into your bloodstream. Brown pee and clogged kidneys then result, which is not a good time. If you're thinking, I'm never drinking that nectar from Satan again, do not worry, those toxic reactions won't happen at normal consumption levels. Thank God. Just, again, when you start getting in excess of 500 to 600 milligrams per day for a typical adult, you're going to start to have a bad time in many cases. And even less for the littles. And now for a bonus fact. Well, speaking of Satan, prior to being baptized in the 16th century by Pope Clement VIII, coffee had been thought by many Catholic leaders in Europe to be Satan's drink. Really? Satan's got good taste. Whether because of its characteristic dark color and bitter taste, both of which were the antithesis of sweet wine, which was associated with the Eucharist and Christ, its physical effects, or its roots in the Muslim world, or all three, many Catholic clerics were therefore solidly against the beverage. As to who first brewed the first cup of Joe, well, that isn't known, but that hasn't stopped many a fictitious origin story from popping up, such as the commonly repeated legends that coffee was first discovered in the 19th century by an Ethiopian herdsman, Kaldi, who noticed that one of his goats appeared to be particularly frolicsome after consuming some red coffee berries. Giving it a go himself, he soon felt more upbeat. Energized, he relayed his discovery to his neighbors, and coffee consumption was born. However, it really came to be discovered as a stimulant. Over time, coffee became popular throughout Ethiopia, where it was said the warriors of the Gala tribe mixed it with butter and ate it before going into battle. Eventually, by the 12th century, Arab traders returning to what is now Yemen from Ethiopia brought coffee with them and learned to cultivate the plant. By this point, the beans were being transformed into a drink by means of boiling. In the 15th century, Ottoman Turks brought coffee with them when they conquered Constantinople. At this same time, the Mufti of Aden, who had been suffering with an unidentified illness and was cured after drinking coffee for the first time, touted its beneficial qualities, which contributed to its popularity throughout the Muslim world. Also in the 15th century, the first coffee houses began appearing in Mecca and Constantinople, and like today, they were used not only for drinking coffee, but socializing as well. By the end of the 16th century, coffee was found in Venice, and by the turn of the 17th century, Catholic Church leaders were becoming suspicious of coffee and the effect it had on the local populace. Deciding it must be Satan's drink, many local clergy beseeched the Pope, asking him to prohibit its consumption. Trying it for himself, Pope Clement VIII, 1536-1605, I found it agreeable, and demonstrating a gift for diplomacy, declared in 1600, "Why, this Satan's drink is so delicious that it would be a pity to let the infidels have exclusive use of it. We shall cheat Satan by baptizing it." With the Pope's blessing and its natural addictive qualities, coffee soon spread across Europe. So I really hope you found that video interesting. If you did, you know what to do. Smash that like button below, and don't forget to check out Scott's show, which I'm linking to below. It's called Medical Confessions. It's a great one. Check it out. And thank you for watching.